That's my best friend.
Peace and assalamu alaikum, family. This is your brother Malcolm Flex TV, and we are back, we are back, we are back. So glad and happy for you to tune in to another video of your brother Malcolm Flex. And this video is very important that we put this message out to black people who do not understand the importance of our black liberation movements, right? The ones who don't understand the importance of our black liberation movements and why the Nation of Islam in particular and other black liberating movements have to stand. They have to stand and stay in place. And today we will be using Colonel Muammar Gaddafi and Libya as an example, right? Because there are too many instances where I am seeing and we are seeing how black people within the black community, we are trying to find ways to undermine and topple and bring down our own liberating, our own liberation movements. So I want to use Muammar Gaddafi and Libya as a living example of why we have to stop with the wanton criticism and why we have to stop helping our enemies divide our communities and destroy our movements. Because is it possible that we are a part of a conspiracy and don't even know it? Right? Is it possible that we are a part of a conspiracy and we don't even know it? Right? So, at this time, I'm going to kind of give you all a background of our brother Muammar Gaddafi, so you'll have an understanding of where I'm going to go with this, right? Because Western media has portrayed this brother in a certain kind of light, okay, that is furthest from the truth. So I'm going to kind of give you a background of who he was and what he had done for the Libyan people when our brother was alive. And I'm going to compare it to what's going on today if we don't be on code and guard and protect one another and our leaders and our organizations. Okay? Okay. So, when analyzing the standard of Libya, right? And also, I'm reading an article. It was posted by Alexandra Valiante, November 9, 2011. It says, celebrating the great achievements of Muammar Gaddafi. Right? It says, when analyzing the standard of living in Libya, it is important to put the achievements into context. During the 1950s, under the leadership of King Idris, Libya was amongst the poorest nations in the world with some of the lowest living standards. From the early 1980s until 2003, Libya were placed under heavy sanctions by the U.S. and U.N., which had the result of strangling Libya's growing economy, leading to an inevitable smothering of development, projects, and social welfare schemes. Despite this, the Libyan Arab Jamahiriya Jamahiriya means for the masses of the people. Okay? And I'm going to give some more context on that. But Jamahiriya means for the masses of the people. Okay? It says, despite this, Libyan Arab Jamahiriya achieved the highest living standard in Africa. Right? Under Muammar Gaddafi. Libya has also invested heavily in African development initiatives. The funding of infrastructure projects, as well as African political and financial institutions, was aimed at developing Africa independently and combating the economic exploitation of African resources and labor by outside powers. Right? They were trying to get rid of the outside powers, such as the Jews that were living in India, Libya, the Italians, America, the UN, Britain, and so forth and so forth. Because Africa has been colonized. So Libya and Muammar Gaddafi was working to get rid of the colonizers who were colonizing Africa. Okay? Human Development Index is a composite statistic used to rank countries by level of human development and separate very high human development, high human development, medium human development, and low human development countries. The Human Development Index is a comparative measure of life expectancy, literacy, education, standards of living for countries worldwide. It is a standard means of measuring well-being, especially child welfare. It is used to distinguish whether the country is a developed, or an underdeveloped country, and also to measure the impact of economic policies on quality of life. Okay, each year since 1990, the Human Development Report has published the Human Development Index, which was introduced as an alternative to conventional measures of national development, such as level of income and the rate of economic growth. The HDI represents a push for a broader definition of well-being and provides a composite measure of three basic dimensions of human development: health, education, and income. Libya Arab Jamahiriya's HDI is 0.760, which gives the country a rank of 64 out of 187 countries with comparable data. The HDI of Arab states as a region increased from 0.444 in 1980 to 0.641 today, placing Libya Arab Jamahiriya above the regional average. Above the regional average, right? So they was over there doing something in Libya that had never been done in Libya before. Right? So let's see some of the things that Muammar Gaddafi had done for the Libyan people when he took over power. Okay, this article is Libya, 10 Things About Gaddafi They Didn't Want You to Know by Global Research News. Okay, this article was first published by Global Research in November 2014. Today, Libya as a nation state has been destroyed by U.S. NATO. Okay, what do you think of when you hear the name Colonel Gaddafi? Tyrant, dictator, terrorist. Well, a national citizen of Libya may disagree, but we want you to decide. For 41 years until his demise in October 2011, Muammar Gaddafi did some truly amazing things for his country and repeatedly tried to unite and empower the whole of Africa. Okay? So despite what you've heard on the radio seen in the media or on the TV, Gaddafi did some powerful things that are not characteristics of a vicious dictator as portrayed by the Western media. Here are 10 things Gaddafi did for Libya that you may not know about. Okay? In Gaddafi's Green Book, because he wrote a book, it's called The Green Book, it states, the house is a basic need of both the individual and the family. Therefore, it should not be owned by others. Gaddafi's Green Book is the formal leader's political philosophy. It was first published in 1975, and it was intended reading for all Libyans, even being included in the national curriculum. Under Gaddafi, Libya could boast one of the best healthcare services in the Middle East and Africa. Also, if a Libyan citizen cannot access the desired educational course or correct medical treatment in Libya, they were funded to go abroad. They was paying for people's education and healthcare in other countries if Libya couldn't take care of it. The largest irrigation system in the world, also known as the Great Man-Made River, was designed to make water readily available to all Libyans across the entire country. It was funded by the Gaddafi government, and it said that Gaddafi himself called it the eighth wonder of the world. If any Libyan wanted to start a farm, they were given a house, farmland, and livestock, and seeds, all free of charge. When a Libyan woman gave birth, she was given $5,000 for herself and the child. Electricity was free in Libya, meaning absolutely no electric bills. During Gaddafi's reign, the price of petrol in Libya was as low as 0.14 per liter, 14 cents per liter, right, for Libyan gas, Libyan petrol. Before Gaddafi, only 25% of Libyans were literate. This figure was brought up to 87% with 25% earning university degrees. Okay, the Libyan literacy rate was at 25%, but when he got over the leadership, it went up to 87%. Libya had its own state bank, which provided loans to citizens at 0% interest, family. 0% interest by law, and they had no external debt. Libya was not in debt to no other country, but America is. America's in trillions of dollars in debt to other countries. And before the fall of Tripoli and his untimely demise, Gaddafi was trying to introduce a single African currency linked to gold. Following in the footsteps of the late great pioneer Marcus Garvey, who first coined the term United States of Africa, Gaddafi wanted to introduce and only trade in the African gold dinar, a move which would have thrown the world economy into chaos. The dinar was widely opposed by the elite of today's society. Who could blame them? African nations would have finally had the power to bring itself out of debt and poverty and only trade in the precious commodity. They would have been able to finally say no to external exploitation and charge whatever they felt suitable for precious resources. It has been said that the gold dinar was the real reason for the NATO-led rebellion in the bid to oust the outspoken leader. Right? Hold on. Okay, so education and medical treatment were free under Gaddafi. Education and healthcare were free for all. A response to this claim by Masarif Edaria, a Libyan citizen, claimed the quality of education and health was appalling. But that does nothing to the fact that it was free. No system is perfect, but most are imperfect and still expensive. Gaddafi made sure his system was subsidized, and even Mercy Corps attested to the fact, and it's beyond Gaddafi, Libya governance context that is more than the so-called democratic leaders can say for their countries. Newlyweds received U.S. $50,000 from the government. Okay, Gaddafi's government had legislation providing for a grant to newlyweds to buy their first apartment so as to help start a family. Okay. Libya had no external debt and had reserves of $150 billion, most of which were frozen globally. Right? They had no debt. Having a home was considered a human right. Okay, there was no homelessness in Libya. With free health care, free education, there was gender equality in Libya. People had enough food. People didn't go hungry in Libya. And then there was privatization of all Libyan oil to every Libyan citizen. Okay, on the 21st of February, Gaddafi launched a program to privatize all Libyan oil to every citizen of Libya. This would initially provide $21,000 to every citizen from a total of $32 billion in 2011, and effectively led to the dissolution of the ministries of health, education, and others to eliminate corruption, theft of oil by foreign companies, and a decentralized power. So every Libyan citizen got a stipend of $21,000 off of Libyan oil. Okay, so this is a man that did the most for his country and his nation. And this is the type of stuff that we hope to do in the Nation of Islam and within the near future. Right? America, the dollar, the American dollar has no monetary value. It has no monetary value, right? Because America is in debt. So Gaddafi was like, well, you know what? We're not going to be trading oil to Americans for the American dollar because the American dollar has no value. So why are we accepting your money when it's not even worth anything? So instead of trading oil for dollars, we're going to start trading oil for gold dinars, for actual gold. But what President Obama and Hillary Clinton did was say, you know what? We don't have gold to trade for this oil. We need this oil. So it'd be best if we just go ahead and kill Muammar Gaddafi and take his gold and destroy his country. Right? Because a lot of people don't really know about, or some of us aren't even old enough. And I'm one of them. I'm not old enough. I wasn't around in the 70s, but I do my research and I know and understand that there was a meeting by OPEC, right? OPEC, for those who don't understand, are the oil producing nations in the Arab countries. The oil producing nations within the Arab countries, right? And they held a meeting in 1974 in Lahore. right? They held a meeting in 1974 in Lahore. It's called the Lahore Summit, right? And I'm going to read some of this and what happened at the summit. This is the Dunya News, right? It says, on this day, in 1974, Lahore hosted the faded leaders of Islam, of the Islamic world. And I'm going to tell you what they did to the Western nations and how they crippled the Western nations. Okay, the participants were leaders Bhutto, Mujib, Shah, Faisal, Sadat, Arafat, and Gaddafi, right? But I'm gonna read. All died unnatural deaths, right? On February 22nd, 1974, the Lahore hosted all the leaders of the Islamic world in the Summit of Organization of Islamic Cooperation, OIC. The city was jubilant as its heroes, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, presided over the summit, which some of the biggest names in the global politics of that time were attending. At that time, these leaders probably had no idea of what lay ahead for them. Some of the most shocking news headlines were going to hit the TV screens and newspaper front pages over the next few years. Okay, one of the participants, Shah Faisal, was the king of Arabia at the time, Saudi Arabia. He was assassinated by his half-brother. It started from Shah Faisal of Saudi Arabia on March 25th, 1975, just about a year after this summit. Shah Faisal was hosting a delegation from Kuwait in which one of his half-brothers was also present. Okay. And Faisal bin Musaid took a pistol out of his pocket and pulled the trigger. He snuck in the king's palace, right, and assassinated King Faisal, right? Sheikh Mujib of Bangladesh was murdered by his army, right? Less than 5 months after the assassination of Shah Faisal, Bangladesh founder Sheikh Mujib Ur Rahman was murdered by his army. Zulfikar Ali Bhutto had a judicial murder, right? They accused him of killing somebody and accused him. Oh, I'm going to just read it. It says, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto had played the pivotal role in this massive event that they put together in Lahore in 1974. He had used his diplomatic skills to perfection in making possible the summit, which had combined all the leaders of the Islamic world on one platform. Pakistan was at that time struggling to find its feet back after the defeat at the hands of India in 1971 and the consequent succession of Bangladesh. It was a landmark achievement of his government that was able to make Pakistan the center of the world attention once again, but for all the positive reasons this time. In this way, he had also ended Pakistan's isolation in the world community. But things were not meant to remain rosy forever. In 1977, Bhutto's Pakistan People's Party won the general election in a landslide. The nine-party alliance opposing him claimed that the election was rigged, and the subsequent movement resulted in General Zia-ul-Haq's coup on July 5, 1977. The Zia government then tried Bhutto for murder of Muhammad Ali Kasuri. The former PPP leader who had fallen out with Bhutto, the court decided the case against Bhutto and sentenced him to death in an unprecedented 4-3 split decision. Bhutto was executed and hanged on April 4, 1979. One of the members of the bench, Justice Nasim Hussain Shah, later admitted that his sentence could have been reduced. Okay? And then after that was President Anwar Sadat of Egypt was murdered on annual day parade. Okay. Khalid Islam Bolli murdered Sadat during the parade as he was observing the troops. Islam Bolli was a lieutenant in the Egyptian military. Okay, the fatwa against Sadat had been obtained from Omar Abdel Rahman, a blind cleric who had lived in the United States for most part of his life. Okay, so Sadat was assassinated, okay, at a parade by one of his lieutenants in his own army. And Yasser Arafat was poisoned. Yasser Arafat was the leader of Palestine. So everybody who attended this conference in Lahore, besides Muammar Gaddafi, were all killed and died by unnatural deaths. Okay? And many believe that the CIA played a role in that. Right? But why were they killed? Okay? What were they talking about at this conference that had them killed? Okay. We gonna deal with it. Hold on 1 second. Sorry for that, family. But okay, so let me show y'all this video, because this is important for context. This is the 1973 oil crisis, and we're going to explain why America had to kill these leaders.
This is NBC Nightly News, Wednesday, October 17th. Reported by John Chancellor.
Good evening. The Middle East war produced developments all over the world today. The oil-producing countries of the Arab world decided to use their oil as a political weapon.
Even before today's meeting began, there was an announcement in Kuwait that prices for Arab oil were going up. A huge increase voted in an overnight meeting without even consulting Western buyers. Then the ministers began what was to be an eight-hour meeting, resulting in their decision to reduce the flow of oil to America and other nations supporting Israel. The cutback will be 5% for the first month and an additional 5% for each passing month, until Israeli forces leave occupied Arab land. The ministers added an appeal to the American people to stand beside the Arab world.
Hey kids, plug into the famous, maybe they'll mind it. But then it makes them mad. We shall survive. In November, General Motors cut production by 79,000 automobiles. Big car dealers began to think small.
The oil embargo came along and couldn't sell big cars at all. As a matter of fact, people that had bought big cars were bringing them back and leaving them on the lot. So here, I don't want it. I won't be able to buy gas for it.
So, family, the Arab nations were upset with the Western nations for backing Israel because Israel was attacking these Arab nations. So they said, well, if you're going to support Israel in being an aggressor and attacking these Arab nations, okay, we're going to put a oil embargo on all Western nations. So that's what that meeting of Lahore was about. With OPEC, the oil-producing Arab countries. Okay, that's what that meeting was about. They said, we all gonna come together. We gonna put our little beefs and dramas to the side, and we gonna come together, and we gonna make these Western nations, America, the UK, and all these people feel it. So all the Arab leaders that were at the Lahore summit ended up getting killed. And Muammar Gaddafi was one of them. And President Barack Obama, Hillary Clinton were the people who actually had Muammar Gaddafi killed with the help of NATO. Okay? It just took a little longer for them to get Muammar Gaddafi, but they had been bombing Libya the whole nine. Libya was a beautiful place to live at one time. You know, but now when you go to Libya, you know, it's the wasteland. You know, Libya is a wasteland now. When you go to Libya, right? And the same, but the whole point of this was that the CIA and the American government, the UK, the Israeli government, all of them played a part in brainwashing the Libyan people. And they turned the Libyan people against the government. And many of them became the rebels. And many of those rebels were ISIS. Right? Many of those rebels were ISIS. Right? So America supposedly had a war on ISIS. But they were also arming the rebels. They were America and Barack Obama, Hillary Clinton was also arming ISIS and the rebels in Libya to perform a coup of the Libyan government and take out Muammar Gaddafi. So the same people that America said that they was at war with, they was actually arming them. So my message to Black people is to take what happened to Libya and these other leaders into consideration and why we should protect our Black Liberation Organization and our Black Liberation leaders. Because the enemy, all he wants to do is keep his hands clean. And allow the people to do the dirty work. The enemy wants to use you and make you a part of a conspiracy and you don't even know it. So this is the reason why the Nation of Islam must stand. and other black liberating organizations and other black leaders. They must stand. We must protect them and keep our business in-house. So this is your brother Malcolm Flex TV. I didn't really expect this video to be this long, but I hope it was informational and educational, and I hope it can help us take in consideration our actions and our words before we come out in public and saying things that don't even make sense. So this is your brother Malcolm Flex TV. We out. Peace and assalamu alaikum. Your shadows.